the vaccine is being acquired by the federal government in the United States, and those allotments are being distributed to the states, and each state has its own plan for distributing the vaccine. Initially, the vaccine will be distributed by those entities that receive the allotments, which will be primarily hospitals, public health departments, and so forth, that are going to be asked to immunize those at the highest risk. And that will include mostly healthcare workers and first responders. Over time, as more vaccine becomes available, it may be available at pharmacies. It may be available through physicians' clinics or offices. But it really depends on the distribution of the vaccine, availability, and timing. The recommendations are that the first doses of the vaccine go to healthcare workers, primarily those with direct care responsibilities of COVID-19 patients, as well as first responders who might be at risk of exposure. We don't know. Again, the distribution of vaccine is currently fairly tightly controlled, and we're in limited supplies. As those supplies grow, they will start to be made available to pharmacies. Pharmacies have also been contracted to make certain number of vaccines available to high-risk populations, like patients in skilled nursing facilities or nursing homes. So they will be helping support that higher-risk population. And essentially, the expectation is once most of the high-risk populations have been offered the vaccine, it would then be made available to the larger general public. Unfortunately, no. The vaccine should really be thought of as another tool in our toolbox to help reduce the impact of this disease. But there aren't specific data about the vaccine itself preventing transmission. And so it's important for folks to continue to do what they're doing around masking, hand washing, and physical distancing. Emergency use authorization allows the FDA to authorize a product that's either not yet approved for a specific purpose or a product that has been approved for a separate purpose. And this is something that's been used in the past for other pharmaceuticals. So it's not a new concept. And again, the FDA is still going to be looking very closely at safety and efficacy data before they make a ruling about an EUA. The steps used to create these COVID-19 vaccines are the same steps used to create other vaccines. The reason it's becoming available sooner than normal depends a lot on the availability of financial resources that have been given to the vaccine manufacturers that enables them to concentrate their resources, whether it be staff or equipment or time, to focus almost exclusively on manufacturing these vaccines. Pharmaceutical companies have been incentivized financially, which allows them to concentrate their resources to manufacture the vaccines, and that's allowed them to be developed in a very short period of time. Currently, the money is coming from countries, primarily Western nations, that have invested finances into pre-orders of many doses of the vaccines amongst some of the major manufacturers that are currently in development. Right now, we don't know because the specific guidelines have not been given. However, it's generally not recommended to take different doses of different vaccines. So the expectation is if you receive the first dose of one vaccine, you should complete that series by getting the second dose of the same vaccine. We don't know specifically, but the thought is if we have a vaccine that's both safe and relatively effective, a single vaccine or a complete series of that single vaccine should be sufficient. Time will tell as we see the efficacy data over more periods of time. But for the most part, the expectation is that as long as you complete the series of one vaccine for COVID-19, that should be sufficient. There are estimates ranging from as low as 30% to as high as 70 or 80%. Frankly, we don't know. We do believe that there is some sort of immunity conferred from previous infection. We expect that immunity will also be conferred from a vaccine. So the more people who get the vaccine, to add to those who have previously been affected, should help hopefully slow the transmission of the virus. Unfortunately, yes, for the time being. The vaccines that are currently being developed don't specifically address the issue of transmission. What they are looking for are, can they reduce the likelihood of symptomatic disease? And so with that, we cannot guarantee that the vaccine itself would prevent an individual from transmitting it to somebody else if they were infected. Similarly, so we have had, as you mentioned, very few cases of reinfection. Although those data are limited and those case numbers are very small, it's still important for us to continue to use all of the measures that we've been doing, at least for the foreseeable future. That's always a possibility, and time will tell. That's one of the reasons why you do post-release studies, to make sure both the safety profile is monitored as well as the efficacy. The studies are done in defined populations that may not be as equivalent to populations who would receive the vaccine in the future. And so we really have to monitor those data over a period of time. It's, again, very normal, even release of a vaccine under slower timeframes, to continue to do the safety and efficacy monitoring. It's simply a fact of vaccine manufacture and distribution. And so one of the things we'd like to see with these vaccines, since we only have data from short windows of time during which they were in protocols, what do those data look like when you're given to larger numbers of individuals over a longer period of time?